The following is part of Cornell Contemporary China Initiative Lecture Series under the Cornell East Asia Program. The arguments and viewpoints of this talk belong solely to the speaker. We hope you enjoy.
Thank you so much, Robin. Thank you so much for the invitation to the initiative and to EAP staff and all of you for being here. I know that in the past weeks that I myself sometimes have struggled to feel grounded in this bit of my own work when so much is happening out in there in the world. So I really appreciate all of your attention and time here today. Thank you. This work that I'll talk about today is a part of my larger book project, which examines China's contemporary change, its urban planning and construction, and its environmental policy in a global context. Over the past decade, China has built hundreds of satellite new towns and peri-urban districts. Its program of construction is frequently described as a singular process of state-led urbanization unfolding across China's countryside, changing village by village, field by field. However, I argue that such an approach conflates the multiple and variegated social and spatial processes of rural urban transformation, and in doing so, major issues and fallacies arise. First, it commits the same kind of ecological and metonymic fallacies that are attributable to the Chicago School of Urban Sociology, old as it is, a unified and singular kind of urban question with its own teleologies and ways of seeing cities as different only in matters of degree and not necessarily kind or category. And so, and likewise, obliterating questions of rural change and the salience of separate rural questions alongside urban ones, in the plural for both. Second, it obliterates questions of radical social, cultural, and environmental change, of affect, resistance, compliance, and consent to dispossession, loss of livelihood, and resettlement into widely varying circumstances. And third, what I'm going to try to focus on today is that the remaking of social spatial structure on this kind of a scale, the size of China, and as a single national territory in ever kind of proliferating practices that aim to integrate everything from the village scale on up to the entire territory. That scale, that change of that scale entails changing environmental values and new social relations to underpin them. A brief example of what I mean from the land use master plan of Yixing, where I've done the bulk of my case study field work. I quote, "The ecological optimization of land use structure requires the closure and relocation of Taihu, shoreline towns, and a considerable number of enterprises and villages. This will transform farmers' traditional cultivation customs. This will be done. This involves many contradictions and problems. The correct management of the relationship between land utilization and ecological protection is an extreme challenge," end quote. And so, in order for these values, what I'm calling environmental values, to be transacted through market means, which is often the overarching explanation of China's drive for urbanization, right? To create a unified land market, to allow that to then allow also for a unified labor market and for market mechanisms to reallocate resources away from lower cost, lower added value industries, and to drive more spending internally and to allow a full market condition to take hold across the entire country. But these kinds of processes and ways of then using market values to allocate and transact value, especially for land, as so much recent scholarship has shown us, that land itself in China has not developed its own kind of free market mechanisms and depends very much so on the intervention of the state, not least of which on the processes that I'll talk a little bit about today. Non-market means of coercion and political tactics that include things like education campaigns and propaganda, but also relies most heavily on coercive force. I'd be happy to talk a bit more about the land market and those other processes. I've heretofore kind of concentrated more on that kind of aspect of these empirics and writing about these projects. And today's work is kind of another aspect that I hope to expand and explore in the book. And so it's a bit information. I hope to hear your feedback and reactions today. All of this takes a much more kind of ethnographic turn. And so I'll begin. Here, underneath the sign, you see Ms. Yang. She returned to her land at the former site of Sizhuang village most every day, retreading her two-year path through the decorative landscaping of flower beds and pre-grown trees that fringed the rubble of her village. We passed beneath a billboard that proclaimed, "New talent, new industry, a new city." Yang set a tattered plastic bag with a small trowel and a clipper on the edge of her vegetable patch. Beyond a mound of broken and weed-covered bricks, she pointed and blinked at what appeared almost as a mirage. Rising in the background before us was a bright green-yellow field of mature rice, shui dao, she said, that was ready for harvest. In fact, she said, it was late, and that she would usually already have begun undertaking the task, but that now Ms. Zhang, a contract farmer who she had met and had been contracted not by her own village committee, but by municipal level authorities, would be doing the harvesting very soon. She owns tractors and will bring 5 or 6 workers to finish it very quickly, probably in less than an hour. Yang complained that she and her neighbors had had no choice in the matter, and that in fact her own village committee had been dissolved in the process. On the reverse of that sign is this other billboard, a reverse angle from where we were standing, that read, exhorted people to construct the commanding heights of talent, technology, and industry, da zao, to create or develop people's talent, go jian, to construct and to establish the commanding heights of technology, and yinlin, to lead the way then teleologically from these new inputs into production as the developmental destination. At first, this appears as a very familiar modernist kind of exhortation, a Maoist intervention into the rural society that would change people's interaction with each other and with production, and then create something for the nation. However, while this sign stands here at the edge of what had been Sizhuang village, it is actually not meant for any of its residents. In fact, none of the industries that were being built directly employed anybody that was displaced from the over 330 square kilometers of all the projects that were being built under the banner of ecological civilization and state-designated eco-city projects. I argue here, then, that outside of the domain of what had heretofore been the kinds of social change and environmental change that were driven by mass mobilization campaigns and slogans that exhorted individuals' participation, that this represents a clear and massive scale disarticulation of what's been called over the last couple decades the three agrarian questions of peasants, village society, and production, ones that had before been tightly bound together in the social spatial fabric of the agricultural village and landscape, disarticulated into problems of biopolitical population, environmental optimization, and modernized production, and corporatized production. And so here, I raise the puzzle of politics and perceived legitimacy and ongoing compliance to party state authority in wreaking such massive and rapid change across the entire territory. A puzzle that during a time when the party state is evidently greatly sensitive to and concerned about its own stability and social stability and the reach of dissent and protest politics, that at a time when those sensitivities are increasingly evident and drive reactions to local government level misdeeds and corruption, that at a time when popular reactions to land dispossession result in the greatest number of mass incidents across the country every year, that this is a puzzle that the source of revenue and development is wholly predicated on forceful dispossession. So that the redistribution of the wealth that can be created through new industries, giving people of quote unquote new talent and technology a place to live and be, requires a bargain in which I as the party state, take everything away from you in order to give you something that's ostensibly better. And in this, I'd like to argue that there's something between the kind of, if it's in strict kind of Gramscian ways of conceptualizing hegemony, that here we see what we might just easily regard as domination, right? But this is the domination of over half of the country's population, that they're not being wholly engendered into consent-driving, consent-eliciting forms of politics, that there's a massive amount of exclusion and inequality that is rising with this. And so this work I am setting in, I hope, a complementary way in relationship to some political science work that that does not take on this question of parsing the difference between compliance to authority and actual political legitimacy or a felt feeling that might then reflect consent of the party state's legitimacy. And so I think that a holding of a kind of ambivalence towards the question of legitimacy and people's active parsing of a question of compliance to authority and the legitimate, quote unquote, application of authority vis-a-vis law is totally different from a moral kind of authority and legitimacy that might be considered the true sign of active consent. And so here, I want to say that sociologically, I think a main question that we might be concerned with is, well, what do people do that's different? And I think that that is a really important question, but at the same time, I think that it's not one that is always easily answered at during a time of change. And so on the one hand, I don't want to say that there's some kind of a lid that's being kept on a cauldron or Eli pointed, I'm sorry, the volcano metaphor, that there's a volcano ready to erupt in China at any time. I'm not trying to predict that, but at the same time, I do think that there is a very important anthropological reason why we should try to understand how people move through such difficult processes and what it might mean for how they understand their relationship to the state, questions of development, their membership in a larger community, the size of the nation, and questions of self-sacrifice that mean totally something different in today's China than they did at the founding of the PRC. And so I think here the work of Alexei Yurchak is quite instructive in highlighting this kind of a double experience, at least double, of in his description of the rapid decline of the Soviet Union, everything was forever until it was no more. And I'd argue that just as two decades of studies on China's migrant population have revealed massive structural changes and inequalities that aren't accounted for in all of official policy and discourse that have accompanied the expansion of export industrialization, I argue that the contradictions of China's environmentalization and its planning of social, spatial structure and transformation have far-reaching implications for all of us. The way that the party state might see some of this and how it often gets reported in venues like the New York Times or the Washington Post is that China's taking control of its social and environmental conditions, dealing with pollution, dealing with imbalances in its economy and so forth by transforming where people live and then driving new circuits of capital circulation and accumulation. And so these are a few macro numbers that the government might talk about in relationship to some of these policies and the way that they're often been interpreted in relationship to a larger process of urbanization. So we see urbanization, urban population increasing at the top, a crisis level of gross fixed capital formation in relationship to GDP rising as well, along with the rapid decline of exports and the steady decline of GDP growth as an annual factor. In 2015, which fell nominally to below 6% for the first time in some years. And so these middle two numbers reflect the political economy of urbanization, of the level to which construction itself is driving accumulation. And the way that the party state considers this as making sense is that in the long term, it's going to create a new sector of service economy and also ever shifting places for investment and new industrialization and so on and so forth. It neatly sums up its critical contradictions in its development. That is official kind of terminology, right? In the official translation of what is called the five balances. The first, urban and rural development. Second, coastal and interior. Third, economic versus social. Fourth, the harmonious development of humans and nature. And five, the domestic development versus openness to the outside world. While it's translated officially as the five balances, the term, the wuge tongshou, is actually more directly translated as a rearticulation of centralized planning, tongshou being the practice of centralized planning, and that its rearticulation is as a new growing centralization, a re-centralization, and at the same time an extension over ever broader domains of social and environmental change. So things like this, those of you familiar with some of China's urban planning dreams and processes will recognize this almost as a genre of image. There's hundreds of these being developed around the country. These are state-designated eco-urbanization zones. And so this is the perspective literally from above, right? The kind of zenithal view of the state on the kind of order of space and society. And so since the turn of the millennium, China has developed more and more practices in master planning, model cities, and integrated rural hinterlands that it dubs as being the heart of its program of constructing an ecological civilization, excuse me, Shengtai Wenming Shehui. It's a pillar of its contemporary ideology of development. And so while we see such things in their abstraction and their kind of crystalline perfection in these kinds of renderings, they also present something that can't be cynically dismissed, that these kinds of projects may not achieve the kind of ecological ends that they speak about in official discourse and in planning, but however, they do environmental work, right? There is a redistribution of actual social environmental relationships, if we're talking about villages, from subsistence and surplus subsistence to state-supported grain bank cash cropping and cash crops for export and so on, to ones where people in villages are no longer doing farming. And so I would just sum up on that point by paraphrasing David Harvey in his argument that all ecological projects, all arguments about environmental benefit demand political economic changes, and vice versa, that all political economic projects and arguments themselves entail ecological implications and changes. And so in planning practice, the state is supporting an ever more kind of expansion of the integration, what it calls urban-rural integration, into actual official disciplinary development in education and in the Chinese academy. And so renderings like these, I see more as a window not upon urban development alone, but upon a larger and larger ambit for spatial planning in general. So that things like this, the land use map, the zoning map, is becoming ever more integrated with images and imaginaries like this, from regional scales, provincial scales, regional meaning larger than a city, not larger than a province, but then on up to those scales, trans-province and fully national scales. This is just one such document that represents this kind of an imagination, China's optimized functional zones plan. In its official translations of these documents, they refer to ecological zonation, zonation being a term that comes from ecological sciences and refers to the distinct separation by biophysical features of different kinds of species and habitats. And in these planning documents, along with the past 2 5-year plans, China's party state discusses the optimization of spatial structure for both ecological ends and social ones and economic ones. The idea here being basic concentration of this one here, representing the concentration of agricultural lands and uses in production uses in these kind of pea green soup areas you see spilled across the map. And so these kinds of things, though, are only made rational not by the map, but by even further forms of abstraction and separation from the land itself. Paradoxically, the identification of something like this, like a concentrated area of agricultural production in this kind of zenithal view of China's resources and ecological optimization, is, while it seems site-specific, right? It's related to some larger kinds of ecological and biological understanding, biophysical understanding of landscapes and historical uses in these places. When it comes down to an individual plot, this kind of an imagination is totally disarticulated from the ground and instead asserts the ability of the state to emplace ecological value. And thus, there's a certain kind of abstraction and reification of that value that's fully separated or is separable from the ground and a site-specific approach to land and landscape itself that we might characterize as a grounded biological and ecological understanding of place. That kind of a view is really not captured so much in the land use map or the zonation map, but in something like this. These are spreadsheets used by the Yixing Bureau of Land Management to keep track of the conversion, concentration, replacement, and banking of different areas of different types of land use, especially keeping track of the amount of arable land as an abstract quantity. And so I can talk more about this in Q&A, but this is just something that I want you to take my word for. This is, at this point, I can talk more in detail about the practices, but what is essentially happening is that around the country, land is being accounted for at a national level. There's what is known as the red line, and it has a total quantity, Sherpa Imu, what is that? It's essentially 120 million hectares of agricultural land. But that is defining agricultural land not as land that is being farmed, but land that could be used for these purposes. And indeed, it tries to then, in doing so, allow for local government determination of where these land uses might be best placed, and then also to account for the need, essentially something like eminent domain, where the state decides when and where something might need to be built for a larger public purpose or for development and so on. But it allows an equivalence between, this is historically China's most productive farmland, places like this to be justified as ecologically rational to be transformed into places like this. And so here you see in the foreground some artificial wetlands and tree cover. These are things that are required for Yixing's eco-city designation. But then also in the middle background, what is called high standard agricultural land. And that is by definition something that is using modern cultivation and is not for, explicitly cannot be for subsistence agriculture. And so that which is high standard then is absolutely not of village production, right? And so in the background, you can see Anzhifang, resettlement housing, a massive resettlement housing development for people who have been displaced from village lands that once occupied these sites. I've been developing these arguments and observations of how then the transformation of the landscape itself affects politics and affects people's perceptions of the state and their own experience, how they interpret their own experience of dispossession and change through their experience of the landscape itself. And through revisits, I found that it's incredibly difficult to be fully dismissive of these kinds of tactics that are being employed by the state, that many people over years' time have become increasingly supportive, if not supportive, they enjoy different aspects of the new environment. And here you can see everything in this image that is built construction, as well as the shoreline of this lake. These, I took this picture just a few weeks ago. None of this existed in 2012. So very rapidly, this entire region has been transformed. And so in transitioning from this kind of zenithal perspective of what the state sees as environmental transformation to how people experience it, I'll introduce the concept of rubble. Kind of Schumpeterian notion of creative destruction or other teleological notions of modernization and progress, like that of Benjamin's Angulus Novus as a critique of modernization of this kind of teleological approach, don't account for this kind of an ambivalent, even Benjamin's approach doesn't account for this kind of ambivalence. It still looks at a kind of a churning, an ongoing process, if not moving forward, at least in a spiral. Gaston Gordillo discusses his notion of rubble as what he calls an object-oriented negativity, quote, the void that haunts modernity. I'd like to take a complementary tack. In China's process of such extensive processes of complete social and environmental dislocation, I want to think about the evolving experience of rubble in the environment, and rubble as the environment, as an experience of state-led transformation to millions of people's vitalist ontologies and diverging experiences of their relationships to the state. Rubble, this word is derived in Middle English via Old French from the Latin spoliare and spolium, and it means to plunder. It also means the noun, the skin stripped from an animal. And I find this to be a potent metaphor for considering rubble as the result of violence aimed at stripping value and discarding the wrecked but previously vital body. Elsewhere, I've looked at the mechanics of making village dispossession work financially, it's a political economy for urbanization. But here I'd like to look more at this kind of experience that parallels people's participation in those processes. These etymological roots of rubble echo Sarah Sargeson's evocation of Arturo Escobar in her observation that in rural China, violence is constitutive of an ongoing project of urban development. And so between the kind of deconstructed and reconstructed landscapes, there are ones like this. These persist for many years. While development in some places, like that I showed around the lake, take place rather relatively quickly in the matter of just a few years transforming landscapes such that in my revisit, I was totally disoriented and couldn't locate myself. But some others happen piecemeal and require re-preparations of construction ground and difficulties with floodwaters and the high water table in this area. Indeed, all construction land here had been previously made by villagers themselves from the wetlands over a millennia. And so I'd like to look again at this rubble, not just as a persistent reminder of violence or of coercive force, but to see it as a slow and experienced as landscape foreclosure of the life that existed before. Through revisits and traversing these kinds of landscapes, people find the erosion of a socio-nature of their experience through the changing landscape itself. An experience, moreover, that is mediated and unevenly distributed as environmental. And so I'll talk a little bit more about what I mean by that. In 2008, the Zhao cousins, they call themselves brothers, were evicted from their natal Fenzhuang village, 3 kilometers to the northeast of the Dongzhao Gardens relocation housing that is being built just beyond the fence behind them. Until that time, they had lived through 5 decades of rural production regimes, from collectivization to the household responsibility system, on through the present privatized leasehold system. In the past 20-odd years, the bachelors had depended largely on subsistence agriculture and occasional piecework for their livelihoods. Since eviction, they also received supplementary incomes from lease payments on the remaining village farmland and small payments from the expanded rural pension system, since they were of sufficient age to collect since 2009. For 2 years after their eviction from Fenzhuang, they rented temporary housing in a village just beyond the Mauve, the road's extension towards Taihu Lake. At the time I first interviewed them in 2011, they had been resettled in Dongzhao Gardens for about 8 months. And despite the initial narrative calling Dongzhao a paradise, quote, I quote from a newspaper here, Yixing's cheating sub-district has a rainbow-shaped bridge called Tangtian Bridge. Next to the bridge is a completely new residential development called Dongzhao Gardens. The people call it the evicted household's new paradise. And here, this new paradise at the time of publication was still under construction. And in fact, could not be inhabited by many who were being evicted because of the speculative way that resettlement housing is distributed, that allows each household to select up to maybe even 5 units. And so because many of those evicted from villages are of senior age, like the Zhao's, many landlords would refuse to rent to some of their previous neighbors, fearing that should illness take hold, that people might die and ruin the market commodity that they had just acquired. And so the Zhao's experience, they discussed this feeling of uncertainty and insecurity in being settled here as a result partly of how the place was in a perpetual state of being incomplete. Indeed, they were only able to find a unit that had no finishes applied. The way that these had been distributed to people, they're essentially empty concrete boxes. There was options to buy different kinds of windows. The owner of the place that they, of the unit that they got, in fact, did not have, had the windows removed in order to install them into another place, and when they took possession of it as renters, it had no windows. And so Zhaoke, he said, "We still aren't used to this place," he commented. And then Zhao Di said, "What is there to be accustomed to? This place will never be complete." They talked about multiple dimensions of this feeling of incompleteness, ranging from actual procedural policy difficulties around their compensation money, but also to the landscape itself. And they talked about sitting next to this area where they were just pictured and watching day after day how the tractor moved dirt from underneath itself only to then repeat the process again in what appeared to be a kind of Sisyphean oscillation of the shovel, which we sat and chatted about and were kind of mesmerized by for the length of our conversations. On the other side of the road, a mostly demolished village also reflects the importance of timing in relationship, the temporality of the process in relationship to this experience of the landscape as a mediator of things environmental. That is to say that the social dimensions of inequality were also shaped by things that seem to be out of the immediate control of people. And so while some of those processes of course are wholly within the control of the local government and its office, its dispatched units in the demolition offices, demolition and relocation offices, which operate as private companies. Other units, such as the Beijing Construction Company, which was responsible for building these roads, were able to lease land from people who had previously been displaced, and also some that were still in this existing village, which was ironically called Shengtian after Mao's famous edict, Ren Ding Shengtian, people must conquer nature. And so in this village here, there's two remaining rows. This was the only remaining house in a single row. And this woman was receiving payment to use what had been her forecourt and that the forecourts, the adjoining forecourts of her small production team to process quicklime and to precast parts of gutters for the road. However, this ended up polluting the local waters and turning the soil to a poisonous level of alkalinity such that the other remaining households in the other whole row were unable to continue to do their gardening. And so they had not previously been moved because the compensation package wasn't something that they could live with. They literally couldn't relocate with the terms that had been offered them. And that is because the condition of their houses meant that the level of compensation was so low that they would owe too much in trying to recover permanent resettlement housing. And so in the village, you saw responses like this, small signals, not of absolute refusal, but a gesture. This says, not allowed to demolish. So if you've seen this all over urban and rural China, the character on the far right, Chai, means to cut or to demolish, to tear down. And children had been going around Shengtian and also in a number of other villages. I saw the same thing, sometimes on light poles, sometimes on the ground itself, but often on buildings, and not those that were owned by the people who were doing this painting. I read this as a gesture. I mean, if in another translation, we might see this as not permitted to or not allowed to demolish, but also a sense of needing not to, right? That there's a reason that it shouldn't happen, even if the authority is one that must be abided. And so, reflecting back on the disarticulation of the kind of three agrarian questions, I'm trying to think about how those kinds of social material orders and aspects of society, the village, the peasants themselves, and agricultural production are kind of experienced in different ways in this kind of a transition in the rubblescape. And so as villages are partially demolished and in phases, when people don't even know what the dispossession is occurring for, they don't know what the projects are for, there's a massive amount of uncertainty, as I was indicating with the Giles, but there's also uncertainty that cannot be controlled. This is amid the rubble here. It's hard to see, but this figure here is Lao Jiang. He was in his early 80s. His wife was in her mid 70s. They're both still alive. At the time of this photograph and when I first met them, confronting this rubblescape, they had been unable to move because his wife had previously been sick, and they were certain that they wouldn't be able to find relocation housing. And even as they felt this, they had actually never even been notified of eviction proceedings. So the general process is that a village kind of sees this coming from a distance, right? And then there's official notification of eviction, negotiation over the terms in terms of measuring the household, and things that are really fixed. It's totally procedural. There's nothing that you can really argue over except whether or not something qualifies to be discounted less in terms of depreciation, or something that qualifies as actual living space that has been classified as not living space. But it's all procedural. There's no terms or negotiation over how much you can get per square meter, et cetera. But they didn't even ever get notified that they were going to have their place evaluated. So you'll see that there's no chai on their house. And so these people aren't resisting the process at all, but they've been kind of wholly excluded by it. And yet they have to live in this kind of a landscape. It was for more than 2 years. This is where ostensibly they were going to move to. And by law, all of these units need to be completed before demolition actually takes place. And so the experience of the Zhaos, referring back again, they didn't have that experience. And you'll see that in the previous images, some of these were incomplete. But going back to Lao Jiang, I apologize for that hiccup. This is the view of the rubble from their front door. And over more than 2 years' time, this slowly got cleaned up. Some of this was recycled, some of it was trucked off, and some of it they cleared themselves from the forecourt of the row of their housing. And they began to use this space to try to continue to eke out a subsistence livelihood by using adjacent areas for gardening. They collected soil and piled it on top of rubble and created beds that beans and squash and greens could grow in. And they grew sesame to make oil and also to sell for a little bit of cash. So moving from the village landscape to fields themselves and the question of production, the Yixing projects exhort, again, the construction of the commanding heights of high technology, talent, and industry. And here, what that meant was the construction of the solar voltaics industry. However, these are quite speculative, and they required the reservation of land for the future construction of an industrial cluster that was being proposed by the local government with certain guarantees for joint venture investors from Europe and from and Chinese capital as well, trying to draw in IP and enterprise expertise from outside and capital from within China for the promise of smoothed logistics and actually the management of companies' operations by city government officials themselves in order to smooth the establishment and operation until profitability by the local government itself. And so here you see land that has been cleared and is still designated as actually arable farmland when in fact it's being prepped for these speculative projects. So it's been cleared and it can no longer be farmed. You can see in the center that village rubble has actually been used to fill the irrigation systems, which have been dismantled from the site. And so while there's no immediate investors, and this represented the allocation of over 800 hectares of land, and the designation of a per meter rent value for this land as a commodity that could then be given as a subsidy to private enterprises. But again, of course, that's a rent value that doesn't actually exist. There's not a demand there. It has to be fully brought in by the state itself. And so here are three adjacent, this is just around the corner in an adjacent area as well, that was nearly a square kilometer of three adjacent solar ventures. All of these were built by 2012, but then because of this kind of speculation that happened in Yixing and around the country, Yixing ended up producing close to 10%, or holding close to 10% of China's industrial capacity to build solar panels. Because of this speculative over capacity, there was a massive crash in the global market, and it led to these plants being shuttered by last year. And so while these were being speculatively imagined and capital being sought, the only, and even though some factories, many factories were opening, local villagers could not find any jobs within the factory walls themselves. And many of the older residents then found piecework maintaining landscaping around the construction fences and then around the newly established enterprises themselves. While they couldn't get the new solar and other clean tech industry jobs, which required 4-year university degrees, and indeed that kind of talent could not, by definition, exist in the area because Yixing does not have a 4-year university. People found piecework doing this kind of landscape work for between 50 and 40 RMB a day. This then necessitated the steady increase by Jiangsu and by Wuxi governments to steadily increase the rural pension guarantees for elderly people like this, who then could not make ends meet. And the experience of traversing these lands, these landscapes, as people who still then need to return in order to eke out subsistence and to try to produce in marginal lands for cash, presented incredibly incredible juxtapositions. So this village land, it's the same that I showed a moment ago, belonged to Huixing village. And these former residents were coming back to use some marginal land for gardening of greens in order to sell in a local market. This is another view of another area of that land. And then across the road that woman and her child are traversing was this. This is actually classified as construction land. And so while this is nominally illegal, this kind of reoccupation was tolerated by the government because the construction land itself wasn't ready to be used. And so in these kinds of cracks, the plan itself, while it does not generate what it says it's going to generate, which is solar, and actually in this area, it's a cable manufacturing plant that's a part of that solar cluster. While it does not necessarily generate the construction that it plans for, it does generate a new regime of environmental value, one that has to be coped with, right? And one that people are trying to cope with here by doing what they did before. But this can only last for so long. They can be displaced at any moment. And so then the peasants themselves. I'm trying to speak a little bit to that that experience of what it means then to be a rural resident, right? And not just a rural resident, but previously somebody who had an integral part of building socialism and building the basis for industrialization in past decades of China's development. This is from a revisit. You'll recognize Lao Jiang and Jiang Taitai here in that same spot. But you'll see also that in their age, they've been unable to keep up with even the beds that they created. Most of it is overgrown with weeds. I was stunned to find that they were still there. This was just a few weeks ago. After many years, the house had finally been demolished last year, and they were moved finally into, they weren't able to find temporary relocation housing, but once their actual relocation housing was constructed, they were finally notified and their son negotiated their move and helped them to pay off the amount that they still owed. Not that the whole amount that they owed, but the amount that they needed to pay in order to take possession. But they will, Lao Jiang, he told me that everything was well and that they own the house. But when I asked whether they still made payments, he corrected himself and said that they will always be making payments until they die. Here you see just behind them, they are piling up black sesame stalks to harvest in order to sell the seeds for seasoning and for oil processing. They can make approximately from their labors from the entire season about, I think they said 600 RMB, I'd have to check my notes, which is quite good for this kind of work. Here, Yu Taitai is making mustard greens that she grew in the marginal areas around the construction fence of Dongjiao Gardens. And here she talked about that the mustard greens wryly, she said, "Yo ku, yo suan," they're bitter and sour, referring to her own experience as being relocated to Dongzhou for several years and awaiting permanent relocation housing. During that time, they were constantly overspending the amount of monthly compensation subsidy for temporary relocation housing, and had to continue to try to grow food and minimize the amount to which they paid for fuel, because you can't do direct fuel burning, of course, for cooking in these apartments, and for water and more use of electricity. In one example, Yu continues to try to do her family's washing and her grandchildren's washing in the old manner. When I went to see her again, this was in 2013, after I hadn't seen them for 2 years, Yu inexorably continued to compare her new living circumstances to home. Yet in that word, there was the reminder that there is no comparison, and that better simply does not matter as much as it should. In striving to recognize and perform betterment, Yu would negotiate with her assumptions about how things ought to be done by an urban and modern subject. For example, the washing. She now has a laundry machine at her disposal, and yet she will not brook using paid for tap water to launder clothing. And so rather, she would bring the laundry down 4 flights of stairs, loaded into the bed of her tricycle, and accompanied by her grandkids, make her way out of the Dongzhou complex. Outside, we traverse these areas thickly matted with new canola flowers that aren't being harvested, to the edge of a bit of pavement that is overgrown with weeds and spilling over with decomposing rubble that is mixed with 2 years of dust, soil, and decomposing weeds. Yu pushes the trike out across the broken bricks and tiles, which are worn into a path by hers and others' many passings. After a couple hundred feet, we reach a patch of concrete that has been roughly cleared of the debris. It is still caked with clay, and its edges disappear under the tapered slope of the surrounding rubble and weeds. I realize that this was once the entrance to a home. The tricycle rolls over the remains of a brick wall, and then a threshold, and then beyond it. We are now on another pad of concrete. We are now inside what had been the house. You and the children unload the wash tub and buckets of clothing and step across a packed earth seam onto a clean swept patch of concrete, once the internal courtyard of the house. There, you spends 40 minutes or so raising water, washing and rinsing just a dozen pieces of clothing in a round plastic tub. No matter to you, this is how the washing ought to be done, or how it used to be done. And when she is finished, she begins to wring the water from the clothes, but her hands are stiff and cold, and the clothes remain heavy. Returning to the apartment is a bit slower going, and by the time we arrive at the walkway leading up the narrow road to the stairwell, the round trip journey has taken well over an hour. As we climb the steps back up to the apartment, I insist on carrying the laundry, and Yu lets out a sad sigh. My presence is clear, and our conversation are an out-of-routine reminder of her home, in quotes. Standing out among all those that have entered, sifted down into the background of her everyday life in Dongzhou. So here, as across these different ethnographic moments, the specter of comparisons, what Anderson, Benedict Anderson called the specter of comparisons, is the signal experience of these interactions and transactions with the environment. Comparisons with the former life, that which is actually missed but must be discarded under coercion, and moreover transcended in a negotiated with sense of moving beyond a stage of development or in what Anderson calls a bound seriality of progression of modernity and enlightenment. And in a sense, also transcending beyond care, attachment, and longing. Thank you.